Yeah, so we can start the call. So good morning once again to all of you. And let me remind you where we are. Where we are in the middle of proving Weak's theorem. That's a lengthy proof. It's a that usually is the case when your theorem is that important. So we'll have to sort of go through. The proof of Weak's theorem is, as I tried to explain last time, divided into two stages, at least in the way I do it here. The first stage is proving lemmas, lemma 1 and lemma 2, as we're going to call them, which tell us what happens when you take a normal product without or with contractions and you multiply it by one additional operator. Okay? And then once we're done with those two, we go to the main part, which will be proved by induction. And as you can imagine, what we'll do there, we'll simply write the Weak's theorem for, say, L operators, and then we'll multiply both sides of it by the one more, and then we'll rely on our lemmas to help us out to clean this sort of, well, it's going to be a bit of a mess that comes out, but, you know, it's one of those things. You know, it will get very complicated, and then the lemmas will allow us to shrink it back to the right form, okay? That's the way it is. So let me remind you what we did. So we considered the first of the two lemmas last time, lemma 1, which tells us the following. We take a normal product of m operators, we multiply it by operator mn plus 1, and what we should get on the right-hand side is the normal product of all of these operators plus the sum over normal products where there is there's exactly one contraction involving the operator mn plus 1 with one of the remaining operators. So we have the sum here over I from 1 to n. Okay. Now, the way we structured our proof is by considering two cases. Case A and case B, as I think I called them. So let's mention that we have two cases. Case A is the case when mn plus 1, the operator we're trying to insert into our expression, is the annihilation operator. Case B is the case where the operator mn plus 1 is the creation operator. Okay? Now, case A is rather simple. Because when you have an annihilation operator here, since in the definition of the normal product, annihilation operators are always written in the right closed positions, well, then you can just insert it here. Okay, that's this term. And then here, this will not contribute, because if you have XR, an annihilation operator here, all the contractions of the M XR time are zero. So essentially, the theorem, or the lemma, becomes rather straightforward. So I would say that this is I think we said that A is straightforward, and I just summarized why. Okay? Now, the case which requires more work is the B. So what do we have to do in the B? Well, in the B, our lemma, I'll write it again, has this form. We have a product of M operators. We're trying to multiply it now by the creation operator, say XR dagger. Okay? And we're supposed to prove that you obtain the product of all these operators with X star R dagger in the end, at the end. And then we have a summation, again, over normal products where we are contracting X R dagger with one of these MIs from 1 to N. Okay? That's what we need to prove in case B. And in this particular case, we said that there are two subcases, B1 and B2. Okay? So B1 in our discussion last time was the case where all operators M1 through MM are annihilation operators. I'll just say annihilators. Okay? That's the case that took us more time, and I'll summarize what we did there. And then B2 is the case where Some, I'll just write that some M's, okay, are creation of predicates. Okay? Good morning. I'm just summarizing last lecture, so you really haven't missed anything. Okay? All right. And what we did last time, it took us about 20 minutes or 25 minutes to prove, was what happens in case B1. So let me summarize how the B1 went. Just the sort of final outcome. The proof of B1 was done by induction. Okay? We first, so when we have, what we had to consider in B1, maybe I'll try to write it here for B1, okay? The case B1 means that we have a normal product of XP1 through XPM, just the annihilation operators. Then we have XR Dagger, and we are supposed to get the normal product of all these operators plus a summation over normal products of XP1 through XPI, say, XPM, XR Dagger, where XR Dagger contracts with XPI. We're summing over I from 1 to N. That's what this case is supposed to be. As I said, the proof of it goes by induction. First you look at N equal 1, okay? That is trivial, as we showed. This just reduces to the anti-commutation rule of XP1 and XR Dagger, which we already know, so nothing to prove here. So I'll just say trivial. Well, you know, sometimes I don't like that word trivial. People say, oh, this is trivial, this is obvious, this is apparent. Well, then you kind of look at it, well, how many years you have to study, actually, to get to this trivial situation, right? So it's sort of always interesting. Anyway, I guess we're at the level where we can say it's rather simple. Okay, then we take the induction step. We go from M equal L to M equal L plus 1, right? So what we did is we wrote our lemma, 1 in this case, for L operators. So let me do it one more time. So we have XP1, XPL, XR Dagger, giving us on the right-hand side N XP1, XPL, XR Dagger. I'm just rewriting the expression above for L operators. So nothing really interesting happens just yet. Well, let's have it though. So we are contracting R Dagger with PI here. I goes from 1 to L. And then this is our induction assumption. And we multiply this induction assumption on the left by XPL plus 1. Okay? So then we obtain the relationship that looks like this. We have XPL plus 1, a normal product of XP1 through XPL, XR Dagger. That's the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, we have XPL plus 1, normal product of, okay, I guess I made a mistake once again here. That is where it goes here. So we have a normal product of all operators. So we have XP1 through XPL XR Dagger. Okay, that's the term that is obtained by multiplying the normal product of all operators by XPL plus 1. And then we have the summation. Maybe I'll just write it below. Okay, we end up with a summation over I from 1 to L. XPL plus 1 will be the first term there, and then we have normal product, normal products where we're summing over single contractions involving XR Dagger. So we have this, let's make sure, XR Dagger, we're contracting PI with R Dagger, okay? I hope this is right now. So, and then we said that, okay, let's call this term here A, let's call this term here B, and let's call this term here C, okay? And we have an equation here that says A equals B plus C, which is still true because it's simply based on the induction assumption and just multiplying it by XPL plus 1. And then we worked on it simply, and we proved what is A, what is B, and what is C, okay? So we came up with the following expressions. So for A, we demonstrated Then it equals, so let's write it here, L, A, which is XPL plus 1, normal product of XP1 through XPL times XR dagger outside, in brackets here. Okay, we proved after straightforward manipulations that it equals minus 1 to the L times the normal product of XP1 through XPL plus 1 XR dagger. Okay? Just essentially what you have to do, you can absorb this operator XPL plus 1 in this normal product. Okay? But there's a little price, the phase factor. Then for the B, that was the length, yes, you remember it took us two blackboards to really get to it. Right? That gave us two terms, which are as follows. So let me write the B. B is this one. So we have XPL plus 1, a normal product of XP1 through XPL XR dagger. Okay? We should end up with minus 1 to the L, and we have then a normal product of all these operators, XP 1 through XPL plus 1 XR dagger. Okay, essentially take this in, but there's a second term also which produces a single contraction, namely minus 1 to the L normal product of XP1 through XPL, and XPL plus 1, the operator we're trying to insert, is contracted with XR dagger. Okay, that's what happens here. And then for the C, that was again straightforward. Here, our summation over I from 1 to L, XP L plus 1, the normal product of XP1 through XPI through XPL XR dagger, where PI and R dagger, this is I, are contracted, equals, you can just take this inside, and again, the only thing that happens is the phase factor. So that's the formula for the C. Minus 1 to the L, the sum over I from 1 to L, normal product of XP 1 through XPL, okay, XPL, sorry, XPI, I should say. Use this. Better, I think. PI. We go, we go XP1, XPI, XPL, okay, then we have XR, then we have XPL plus 1, then we have XR dagger, okay, and what happens here is XR dagger gets contracted with XPI, okay? So this is what we get, and we know that A equals B plus C. So when you really see it, when you look into this, you can see that there is a common factor, minus 1 to the L, that when you write A equals B plus C, we can just get rid of on both sides. And then you simply have the following. You have that this, maybe I'll put it in a circle, which is the left-hand side, equals the sum of those two. The first term, as you can see, is the normal product of all the operators, as the lemma wants it. Okay? And if you look at the remaining terms, after getting rid of minus 1 to the L, okay, this term adds this one extra contraction we're missing here. Here we are contracting XR dagger with everything up to this point, but we're not contracting this operator. That's what happens here. So these two can be recombined. So maybe I'll mark them. Sort of. Okay, let's see if I can do this. Okay. These can be recombined by simply saying, extend your summation from I equal over I. Okay, go from 1 to L plus 1 in the summation. And that completes the proof. Okay? That's the structure of the proof. Of course, it took us a bit longer last time. We have to go through all the details, especially with the B, but that's what it was. So now, we are at the point where we can go to case B2. So what happens in our lemma when some operators M in the lemma are the creation operators? Okay? So let's look at B2. So, you know, I'm still having B there, so maybe because you could point to the blackboard, to the top left blackboard for a second.
Yeah.
Or the whole region here, at least so that we can see the top blackboard on the left. There's an equation which says B, and then there's a line that follows, right? That's where we are. And we want to now see what happens when some of these M's there are creational prayers. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to apply the permutation to both sides, which places the creation operators in the M bunch, M1 through MM, to the left. You know, as you normally have to do in the normal product. Okay? That's my first step. So let me start doing this work here, B2. Okay? So what do we get? On the left-hand side, imagine that M1 and M there are the creation operators. So I'm going to end up with, let's call, you know, and I have to permute them. So I have to use symbols like, say, PR1 dagger up to PR. Let's assume that we have K creation operators, okay? And then we will have some annihilation operators. I guess to be consistent, I have to call them PR K plus 1 through XPRM, okay? That's what you get from the normal product of, you know, with the M's, okay, on the left-hand side of the B. Then you have to multiply it by XR dagger, and of course, you have to add the sign of the permutation that we have to apply to rearrange operators so that the creation operators are to the left. That's how the left-hand side will look like. And I dropped already, please note, that I dropped already the N symbol, because everything, you know, the operators M1 through MM now are written in the normal product. Okay, so this part is already in the normal product. Maybe I'll just emphasize to make sure that we're not missing that important part. Okay, what happens on the right-hand side in this case? I have to apply the same permutation. But please note, now it's a little bit different than on the left-hand side. Because I'm permuting only the operators M1 through MM. I'm not touching XR dagger. I want to keep it where it is. So I cannot drop the M symbol. I have to do it inside the M symbol. Right, because inside we can permute, okay? No penalties there. So I end up with minus 1 to the R, this, I mean the sign of the permutation, and then we'll have the normal product. We have XPR1 dagger through XPRK dagger, okay? Then we have XPRK plus 1, I'm sorry, so many indices, but that's what it is. Okay, and then XPRM, okay, that's how what you have for the M1 through MM part, and I will, as I said, I'm going to keep XR dagger here. That's why we have the same sign of the permutation, okay, because the permutation is applied only inside the normal product and to the M1 through MM bunch. Okay, and then of course we have to deal with the summation. Okay, so let's start writing. Again, I'm permuting M1 through MM. So it's going to be the same sign of the permutation. There's a summation over I. It starts from 1. I think we can agree on this. But let's wait for the top, end of the summation for a second. Okay? What do we have there? If I permute, I have a normal product. I will have XPR1 dagger through XP. And then, you know, I have to, you see, if you look at this summation, I have to contract XR dagger with operators M1 through MM. So there are two classes of contractions there. There will be contractions of XR dagger with the creation operators in the bunch, and there will be contractions of XR dagger with the annihilation operators in the bunch. So I'm going to have to split that summation. Since I am using symbol K to say that I have K creation operators, this summation will go up to K. And right, and in this one, I'll just focus on the contractions with the creation operators. So this is going to be, say, PRI, okay? Then you go X dagger PRK, all right? Then we have the annihilation operators. I'm not doing anything to them in this case. So PRK plus 1 through XPRM. Then I have XR dagger, close the normal product symbol. I am contracting this way, okay? XR dagger with one of the creation operators, okay? I would like to do it on this level, maybe let me try. Okay, so then we have the final term, which is the rest of the summation. We are running here from I1 to K, so we have to go from K plus 1 in a natural way, right? All the way to M, okay? And then we have a situation now where our contractions with XR dagger involve involve not the creation operators, this is already done, but then will involve the annihilation operators. So for the creation part, I'll just rewrite them, product of the creation operators, and then I will focus on the annihilation operators. So here we have PR K plus 1. I will emphasize, after some dots, the operator PR, say, I, and then XPRM, and XR dagger. And now, in this part, I am contracting an annihilation operator in our group to XR dagger. Okay? That's how this looks like. If I lower it a little bit, can you see the whole thing? All of you? You know, just don't want to miss anybody. Okay? That's what it is. And now we just have to read what we see. Okay? You can see that the first thing, first observation that you may take is that this term is zero, because the contraction of the X dagger type is zero. So I can just drop it out. So that's the first thing I'll do. Now I'll cross it out and say that's a zero. Okay? And let's then rewrite what the rest of our expressions. Let's see what happens then. Okay? So maybe I'll do it right here. And that will be one. You can see that all three remaining terms have the same permutation symbol. Okay? So I can just cancel it. Well, it's plus or minus, right? So we don't have to write it again. And then let's rewrite all these terms, but in a slightly different form. So let's see what's on the left-hand side. You see, what we have here is a product of the creation operators, a product of the annihilation operators, and the XR dagger. These annihilation operators are in the normal product form. So I can simply throw here the normal product symbol, okay, surrounding this band up here, not this one. Okay? So the left-hand side, after removing the sign, will look like this. We'll have XPR1 dagger through XPRK dagger. Let's put them maybe in brackets. And then for the rest, we have a normal product of XPRK plus 1 through XPRM times XR dagger. That's the left-hand side. Okay? I hope I didn't mess it up, right? So we have the product of the creation operators, you know, I'm not doing anything weird, I just rewrote it, and then I'm emphasizing that the annihilators are in the normal product form.
Are you taking these factors out at the moment?
Yes. That's right, because it's the same in every case, so no need to keep it. Okay, let's look at the right-hand side then. Well, okay, here. You see, here we have a normal product, and these creation operators are already in the leftmost locations. So we can take them out without changing the expression. Of course, I have to keep the remaining operators inside the N symbol, because I still have one creator there. But I can take that group out. So that's what I'm going to do. It's going to be X dagger PR1 through X dagger PRK. So I'm taking this group out, and I am just rewriting the remaining operators inside the normal product. So we have PRK plus 1, XPRM, XR dagger. Okay? That's the second term. Now the third term, fortunately, is gone. Okay? So I just have to look at the bottom part of the summation. Right? Maybe if you could just briefly look at this one. Right? So I will comment on what we're going to do here. Again, remember, as we already said, the sign is gone. Alright? And again, what we have here is a situation where XR dagger contracts to one of the annihilation operators. It doesn't touch those. And they are in the leftmost location, so we can just take them outside. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. Next, I have now plus, so let's go back to this blackboard. We have XPR1 through XPRK, dagger, dagger. Okay, that's the group I'm taking outside the normal product. And I have a summation over I from K plus 1 to M. We have normal product of XPRK plus 1, that's what it is. Then in the middle we have XPRI, then we have XPRM, XR dagger, and XR dagger is contracting XPRI. Okay, that's how this looks like after the rewrite. Okay? And if you really now look at it, I am back in the lemma 1 case. Because what you have here is normal product of an integration operator times the creation operator. We know from lemma 1, it equals the normal product of all these operators plus the summation, which involves the contraction of extra bracket with one of these operators. Okay? So this is simply lemma 1 multiplied on the left by the creation operators. Okay? Lemma 1 is true when you multiply both sides of it by the creation operators. Of course, you're not changing it. So we completed the proof, okay, of the case which we call there B2. So we're done with A, we're done with B1, we're done with B2. There's nothing left, logically speaking. We completed the proof of this whole lemma. Okay? So now, I guess, let me briefly, for the break, do lemma 2. Lemma 2 is straightforward. You see, the lemma 1 is the real thing. Okay? Once we're done with this, we can go to lemma 2. Let me write it maybe. Did you copy this? Well, I'll keep it for a second. Okay, has everybody copied the information? I'm not going to erase it, okay? I'm going to keep it, I'm going to hide it for a second if I need to write lemma 2, and I think it's a good blackboard to do it. So what I'll do, I'll now erase all this discussion, what we were doing, we proved lemma 1, let's formulate lemma 2. I'll try to use this blackboard as a storage place for the lemmas, okay? So lemma 2 is very similar to lemma 1, except that now you have some contractions here which then propagate into here and into here. Okay? That's what it is. So symbolically, we can write it like this. A normal product of M1, I'm going to emphasize one of the contraction operators, no need to write both, and you will see in a moment why. So we have M operators in the normal product, we multiply this by MM plus 1, but I am contracting some operators here. So that's my symbol. Okay? You can write some sort of contraction symbol below. You know, some operators, all I'm saying there is that some operators are contracted. Okay, and MI is one of them. And then on the right hand side, I should end up a normal product of all operators. Where I'm retaining the original contractions, just inserting MN plus 1. And the summation part that we had there evolves into the following form. We have a summation. Since I'm using already I have to call the summation over J, going from 1 to M. But I'll add one more symbol here in a moment, so just bear with me. We have M1 to say MI. I'm going to emphasize another operator called MJ, then MM plus 1. Okay? So what we do here is this. We retain all the original contractions, that's the I, but I am adding one additional contraction, which involves one of the uncontracted operators here with the MN plus 1. Okay? So I'll use the so I'm summing over all J's, but of course you're not touching the MI's because those are involved in the contractions. So I'm going to have a symbol for it, just not to write a lot of things. That my J does not belong to capital C, where capital C stands for indices of contracted, of operators contracted on the left hand side. Okay? So what I'm doing here formally is that I am retaining the original contractions and I'm adding one extra. Okay, involved in the MM plus 1. So let's prove this lemma now. The proof, as you can imagine, is based on, now I can, I guess, go back. Solve it there. The proof will go to the reduction to lemma 1, as you can, again, easily imagine. All right, maybe if you copy this, I will erase it. If you didn't, I'll keep it. Decision? Okay. It's not democracy, but because even if there's a single person who didn't copy, we have to respect that minority view. That's the way it's going to work here. All right? Anyway, so, but if you're happy, I'll start cleaning, start shouting when you feel that I'm erasing something that I should, I'm not supposed to. Okay. Okay, so the proof, as I said, goes by the reduction to the previous case. Okay? So what's going to happen is this. Let's start with the left-hand side in the proof. Okay? The left-hand side, I'll write it a little more explicitly. It's the normal product of M1 through MI1. Let's assume that we have, say, lambda contractions. Okay? So lambda tells you, and I'm contracting, you know, invariant in some particular form. Then we have MM, and then we have MM plus 1. Okay, that's the left-hand side. All right? The first thing you do is use the definition. You know, I take the contraction structure in the left-hand side outside, the normal product symbol. Of course, that will require some permutation, so you have to stick some sign of the permutation. You will have I1 contracted with J1, some dots, I lambda contracted with J lambda. Of course, there can be just as little as one contraction, but let's assume lambda in general. And then I have a normal product of the remaining operators. Of course, you have to repermute this stuff. So I'm going to call them K1 to K mu, which, as I already did before. Okay? So I just use the definition. And just to be formally correct, the two lambda indices involved in the contractions plus the mu indices of the uncontracted operators should give you the original number of M operators, obviously. And to be again formally precise, all these indices, I1, J1 through I lambda, J lambda, this is exactly what I call capital C there, indices of the contracted operators, okay? And those Ks, K1 through K mu, are exactly the indices that do not belong to C. Okay, just to compare with the original writing. Yes?
Just so I'm not confused, the J's at the top and the J's here.
Well, there is, you know, I'm using different symbols altogether, right? Because now nothing is J, nothing is I. It's, you know, at the release you have I1 or I, you know, so I'm, you know, there are formal different symbols, yeah? But yes, you know, if you want to identify the J over there is in the K, right? And then the little I there is one of those, okay? That's more or less if you want to identify. Okay, and you know, the rest of the story is very straightforward. Now I'm going to simply apply lemma 1 to this case. So what do we know from lemma 1? If, you know, the sign I will just rewrite, the contractions I'll rewrite. Nothing I can do about them right now. Okay, but according to lemma 1, you have here a normal product of operators without contractions, so you can insert this inside. Okay, that's the first thing we're going to do. Okay, so essentially do this one. And then, as you know, in lemma 1, there's another term. So I have to, I guess, patiently rewrite the whole thing. Again, the sign, all the contractions. Of course, in your notes, you can sort of say, okay, I'm repeating this part in some way, so you can mark it without rewriting. I just want to be a little bit more complete here. In any case, then we end up with a summation. Okay? Now I'll use J, okay? I'm going to be contracting this with one of the operators here, and I call that contraction J. Okay? So it's going to be J going from 1 to mu. We have mu operators here to contract. So we have a contraction involving M1, sorry, MK1 I should say, MKJ I guess. Then we'll have MM plus 1, and MM plus 1 contracts to MKJ. And I think this is the whole operation, right? Maybe MKU would be, okay, let me modify slightly. It's not important. Let's just be neater a little bit. So MKU is the last of the uncontracted, and then MM plus 1 contracts to MKJ. Okay? All right. So I now use lemma 1. And you know, all you need to do is to read this back. Essentially, as you can see, lower this down. All I need to do now is to apply the inverse permutation of indices, which has the same sign as minus 1 to the r, you know, the original permutation. And I'm going to simply insert our contractions back. Okay? So what do I get? If I take If I look at the left-hand side, well, left-hand side is already written there, okay? So there's nothing to do. It's already normal product with some contractions times m plus 1, okay? So if I continue on this blackboard, okay, what do we get on the right-hand side? Here, from this one, maybe I'll move it up a little bit, what we get is I take all these contractions and write them inside, okay? The sign will be gone when I do this, and I end up with the normal product of m1 through mi1, mj1, mi2, lambda, mj lambda, okay? These are contracted, okay? And we're going all the way to m, m plus 1, okay? That's what happens to this error, okay? This one, I'm marking that this way, all right? But for the other one, for the summation, again, if I take these contractions and write them inside, okay, what I will have is the following. I'll have a summation over j from 1 to mu. We have a normal product of m1, mi1, say mj1, okay? Somewhere in the middle there is this m, mkj, okay? Then you have mi lambda, mj lambda. Of course, these things can be, you know, placed in various locations. I'm just giving an example. And then it's mn plus 1. And we know that mn plus 1 contracts to this, okay? And this is actually the end of the proof, because if you really look at it, what we have is this. We started with the normal product of contractions times the operator. We ended up with the normal product with the original contractions with that operator inside, plus the summation, where in addition to contractions that we already had, we have one extra involving the mn plus 1. Okay, so you can see the rule is very simple. Normal product times an operator, whether you have contractions or not, will be a normal product of all operators. You're preserving the contractions. And then there will be a normal product with original contractions, if there are any, plus one extra contraction involving the last operator. That's the rule. Okay, so proof of lemma 2 is completed. We are now ready to go to Weak's theorem. You know, usually when this sort of stuff happens, I guess we need a break, because we're going to now need a lot of manipulations. You will see actually straightforward, you know, but lengthy, that's, I think, great. Okay, so let's have a, say, 5-minute break, and hopefully we'll finish this up. And I think that if, once we prove the weak theorem, I think that would be a good end of the day, right, to have that behind us. Okay. Have you seen a proof of Weak's theorem?
No.
Because I'm sure some of you must be aware of Weak's theorem, right? It's, it depends, I guess. Mm-hmm. It depends where you are in your research and so on, right? But the proof, have you seen the proof, for example? Yeah. You said that you...
Yeah.
This way or some other way?
I didn't go in nearly as much detail.
Yeah, okay. So I hope it's useful. You know, it's useful. You know, the reason I you know, you may always wonder, well, do I need to prove all of this? Why don't I just state the fact and just teach you how to use it, right? Well, that's one way, right? But, you know, that way does not, I mean, certainly it's okay, right? Many courses are, you know, especially in the undergraduate classes. I mean, you don't explain every fact you're stating, right? You're saying, well, that's the way it is. Just try to remember, you know, at least until the exam, right? But, you know, here, of course, you know, here you want to see that even these very complex, so facts are provable, and they, as you see, if you really look into this, it's sometimes lengthy, but it is not unusual in some way. I'm not using something out of the ordinary completely. I just have to be careful about not missing some index or some term and so on. Okay, and that's what you do in the actual research when you know some new many body theory and so on. You have to really go through the labor in it, right? Whether you use Weak's theorem or, as you will see here, of course, the diagrams. Okay. But you have to sort of convince yourself that you can manipulate with all these expressions safely. Because, you know, there's no point, obviously, in using, say, diagrams if you, you know, you're going to miss the sign or something. Because then you write a computer program and that will immediately show up. It's actually interesting when you write these, you know, computer programs. You know, you look at theories like, say, couple cluster, singles, doubles, triples, quadruples. It's a very high-level theory, right? It has 180 Hugenholz diagrams, probably, right away. Okay, so it's a lot of terms. In weeks there, it will be many more. It will be, you know, close to 1,000. And that's just in a spin orbital form, meaning that I'm not trying to integrate the spin up. If I do that, that's even more. Okay? Because now we have to go through all the spin cases or some recapping. And you know, it's interesting. You take 180 diagrams, you can say, suppose you miss the factor 1/2 in one of them, and then you miss 2 signs in 2 of them. Okay? And you're going to see a significant error. You know, so you say, this is the thing. And it's not, so you say, okay, well, you know, I made an error. It's in chemistry at the level 0.1 millihard tree, right? A 1 millihard tree, that's 0.6 kcal per mole, 0.7 kcal per mole. So you say, well, it's a small number. Now you can't operate this way because I can easily generate the situation, you know, say, stretch a molecule in some way, create much larger correlation effects, and then 0.1 millihard, it becomes 1 millihard, it becomes more. You know, so simply there is, so this sort of way of doing research is such that you're not, when you propose even approximation, CCSDGQ that I mentioned is an approximation. But you want to make sure that that approximation, when you derive it and implement it, is what you are saying it is. Not that you say, oh, some terms in it are not important. Say if I miss some sign, who cares, right? So that's sort of one of those things. It has to be fully reproducible, and that of course means you know, that you have to exercise a lot of sort of extra care. So I guess maybe some role of this course is to sort of go through some of this labor. So. And these proofs are then very useful because, of course, when you manipulate at this general level, then obviously when you have some more specific case, it's easier simply when you see the sort of real proof. Okay, so I guess I'll come back in a second. In the meantime, I'll start erasing. I guess I can erase everything now, right? I mean, I'm hoping that you're fine. Information. I'll keep the lemmas because I guess we'll refer to them. Erase, I guess if I erase C, we know what C stands for. I'll see if I can retain the lemmas, maybe I could save some space. We'll see if I need to move them. Because I probably will need in each case 2 blackboards at a time. Make sure that we see everything that we need to see. Okay. So I guess we'll go with the Weeks theorem, okay? I'm not going to write it, you know, again, I'll write it for the induction assumption because I already wrote it before. You know the meaning of it. You have a product of operators M1 through MM. You should end up with a normal product plus all possible normal products with contractions. So with single contractions, double contractions, triple contractions, all the way to either fully contracted terms, if you have an even number of operators, or terms which are, you know, where you contract everything, all operators but one, when the number of operators is odd. Okay? So we know the meaning. So let's go by with the proof of Weeks' theorem, and the proof will be by induction. Okay? The first steps are simple, so I'll use this blackboard. So the proof of Weeks' theorem. And it's going to be by induction. So when you have to do it by induction, of course, the first thing you have to do, you have to start with the low numbers of operators in our expression. So let's start with just one, m equal one. Well, then what I have is this. I have a normal product of a single operator, and I'm, you know, equal to m1, of course, right? I'm done. You know, there's nothing to contract, so that's all there is to it. Okay, well, let's look at maybe m equal 2, not to be so simplistic about it. So what happens when I have two operators? Weeks' theorem tells you that you should end up with a normal product of two operators plus all possible normal products with contractions. But there's only one contraction, okay? And again, I'm done because this normal product is simply a contraction times the normal product of an empty set, which is a unit operator, so you end up with a definition of contraction, right? Contraction equals M1, M2 minus the normal product. So the M equal 2 case is simply nothing else than the definition of the contraction one more time. Okay? So I guess the interesting case will be to take the induction step. That's what we will try to do next. Maybe I'll try to do it here. So what I'll do is this. I'll write Wick's theorem for the L operators, but now much more careful than before, because we'll be accounting for various constellations or combinations. And then I will multiply the case of M equal L by operator ML plus 1. Okay, so let's go through it. Let's go through it with the appropriate care. So the induction assumption says M1 through ML equals. Please, in each case, leave a little space which will fill. Okay, so I'll write L operators, some little space equals. Let's try to do it this way. So it's there's some pedagogical element. Okay, so then what happens? On the right hand side, I have a normal product of M1 through ML. Okay, let's leave some space. Then we'll have plus sum of normal products with single contractions. So let's write it carefully. We have, say, MI1, MJ1, ML. Again, leave a little space. And then we are summing over I1 less than J1, okay, running between 1 and L. Okay? Please put this L in the circle, or use a different color, whatever is available to you, because we'll be paying attention actually to this little part. It looks like we're writing a lot, but we'll be paying most attention then to where the summations end. Okay, so that's the one I have. Then we have double contractions. So let me write it here. So we have a summation. We have a normal product of M1 through, say, MI1, MJ1, MI2, MJ2, ML. Okay? And I multiply it, and the summation goes over, say, I1, again, let's write it carefully, less than J1, I2 less than J2, of course these are over there, then, so I'm going to contract here and here, then we have I1 less than I2 to be precise, in terms of that you have to order something, so this will precede this, but the J's of course can recross. So all I have to say about the J's are that they are different, okay, so that's really that's what it is, all right, and what is again important is, I'll answer the question in a second, you have to take less or equal L. That is, all these symbols have to do not exceed L. Okay, you have a question.
Fraction on this first.
Yes, very good. Thank you. Okay, please watch, of course, for all the details. You know, let's be in this together. Okay, all right, next. Next, of course, will be triple contraction and so on. So I'll write sort of the middle part. Okay, sort of where the, sort of where, because we have to eventually not prove it by example. We have to prove it such that we see some pattern that is correct for an arbitrary number of operators, okay? So I'll write two middle terms where you have lambda and lambda minus one, so lambda minus one and lambda contraction. So let's write the one with lambda minus one contraction. So we have, so I guess what you can do, you can leave some space, put plus, dot, 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 okay? And I'll continue there with my plus. So what we have here is a summation, okay? We have normal product with lambda minus one contraction. So it's I1J1 dot MI lambda minus one dot MJ lambda minus one. Let's contract them right away, so I don't forget. All right, and then we have ML at the end of this expression. And again, let's spell out the summations to be precise. I1 less than J1 dot I lambda minus 1 less than J lambda minus 1. Then I's are ordered. So I1 less than I lambda minus 1. J's are, don't have to be ordered then, but they still have to be this different from one another. And again, what is important is that in all of this summation, none of the indices exceeds L. So I'm going to put that here, maybe, less or equal L, okay? Put it in a circle, just to remember Then we have hello break, it's not some other number. Let me write one more. It's a little bit boring, but I need it. Okay? The next one will be lambda contractions. It's very similar, but I really need it for you to see the pattern that emerges. Let's actually be careful about the space. That's one thing that we have to be careful about is here. In your note, you know, you have a big advantage writing this on a paper because you can just flip the page. In my planning, you know, if I have just this limited space I have to work with. So let's see what happens. We have M1, MI1, MJ1, MI lambda, MJ lambda. Contract those. ML. And again, we have all these summations over I1 less than J1, dot, 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 I lambda less than J lambda. Okay, then we have I1 less than I lambda, and J's are different. So I'm really rewriting the previous summations arrangement, and all these are less or equal than L. Okay? So, you know, what you see here with the lambdas, I wrote two middle terms, lambda minus one contractions and lambda contractions. Okay, just as two, sort of like a two representative terms in the whole series. And then I continue. Okay, so let's, I guess, right here maybe, leave some space, plus dots. And let's look at the last terms, sort of the end points of our calculation. So, now the last terms depend on the parity. So let's assume first that we have an even number of operators L, okay? So what happens? So maybe I'll put a little line because, you know, we'll have two subcases. Okay? So for the, let's say that this one is for even L. Okay? Then the last terms will be terms that look like this. You have a summation over normal products where you have two operators in the bunch uncontracted. So I'm going to call them, let's say, K prime. So let's have K prime minus one. K prime plus one. Okay, I put this one in a circle. That's the one uncontracted. Then we continue to MK double prime minus one, MK double prime, NK double prime plus one. NK double prime is uncontracted. And then you go all the way to ML. And, you know, just please put some symbols here. All these operators in the first bunch up to K prime are contracted. This one is uncontracted. These are contracted again, all of them in some way, of course in all possible ways. This one is uncontracted, and all of this is again contracted in some way. So just, you know, put symbols like this, right, to emphasize. So what we have here is some groupings, right? Contracted, uncontracted, contracted, uncontracted, and contracted. Of course, you know, the uncontracted ones can be nearest neighbors, you know, all this can happen. So this is like all these terms. So I will just emphasize that we have summation over K prime, K double prime, and of course, a lot more, I guess, in the summation over all these contractions. The point is that this is all less or equal L. Okay? And of course, when you have even L, after this one, you can contract, say, K prime and K double prime to simply have a fully contracted term. So there is one more term in the even case. I'll write it maybe here, which is a summation. Well, that one is, I guess, the easiest to write. You just have M1 through ML, normal product. And just put some symbols. You can simply say all contracted if you like. Okay? Or fully contracted, right? FC. Right? Whatever works for you. One of these are. Just to make sure that that's what we have. That's the even L. By the way, you also can have an odd L. Okay? So let's separate. Because these are optional. You cannot have both. Either this or the one at the bottom, which will be odd L. What happens with the odd L? Well, with the odd L, you cannot contract all the operators. So the last terms will be that everything is contracted by one operator, right? So let me again write it symbolically in some manner. Well, I guess the summation, I have a normal product, M1 through, say, MK minus one, MK, MK plus one, up to ML, the K here is uncontracted, and everything else, you can just again put these lines, contraction lines, everything else is contracted, okay? So again, I'm summing over K,
and a lot more, of course, because I still consider all possible cases where the K is, but the point is that all these indices do not exceed L. Okay? Is this clear so far? Okay. That's where we are. I don't know how. Can you see this one? Actually, you know, if you don't see it, I mean, right now I just have to make sure you copied it. If you did, then I'll lower it. Okay? So now I will go to this blackboard and I will now try to perform a calculation on all of this. What we're going to do now is we'll multiply this induction assumption, weak theorem for L operators, by ML plus 1 on the right. Okay? That's why I ask you for these spaces. We're going to be sticking now, ML plus 1, everywhere. You can do this as well so that you spare rewriting, right? Just okay, so let me start doing it. I'll lower this down. Okay, I'm not erasing it. Nothing is going to be erased right now. I will go down to this one and I'll slowly start plowing through this expression. Okay, so I will now multiply it by ML plus 1. Okay, if you like, I can kind of underline it maybe so that we know what we insert. I will multiply this by ML plus 1. Okay, let's again, maybe. Underline. I'm going to multiply this by ML plus 1. Again, maybe. Okay. If you had a colored pen, you could see this. What did I miss?
First terms, inequality. Yeah.
That's right. Okay, so we multiply each term. The first one, the second one, the third one, then of course you continue. There's the next one here, which has, so I'm going to multiply here. Okay, that's the lambda minus one contraction step multiply. Then I'll multiply the one with L operators. So ML plus one will show up here. Then, and then, you know, these last terms again need to be multiplied. So we multiply here. We multiply here. And we multiply here. I hope that this is all clear. Okay, I haven't done anything just yet. But now I'm going to be doing significant manipulations. Okay? Actually, I'm thinking, you know, so this is maybe the last look at the lemmas. Maybe Nicole could point to this blackboard here, which where I am at. Because we're going to be probably raising them, you know, given the fact that I needed the blackboards. Okay? So I guess that's what we're going to be using. I think you know the meaning of the lemmas, right? So it's probably okay if I erase them, right? Well, you have them in your notes as well, okay? All right, so right now I'm going to erase the lemmas to free us some space. We know the meaning of these lemmas. We just have to, the lemmas, each of the two lemmas brings us two terms on the right-hand side. One with one of them adds one extra contraction. Okay, so let me now start writing what we get. Let's start with the first term. You see, the first term is lemma 1. Okay, if you look here. Normal product times an extra operator. That's lemma 1 case. Okay, so maybe I'll even say here. Lemma, again, Nicole, if you could be with me here, lemma 1, at least for a little while. Right? What happens when you apply lemma 1? So I'd say equals. You end up with two expressions. The first one is the normal product of all these operators. Okay, ML plus 1 ends up inside. The second term is you sum over these operators where ML plus 1 is now contracted with one of the m's, m1. Okay, so we're going to have, say, a summation over k. Let's call it like this, going from 1 to L. And I have a normal product of m1, mk, ml, ml plus 1. Okay, and ML plus 1 is contracted with MK. Alright? That's what happens there. Then we do a similar operation on the remaining terms. So I have here a situation. I have one contraction, ML plus 1. Of course, here I have to apply lemma 2. Because I already have one contraction. That is lemma 2 case. Okay? So maybe I'll write again. I'll emphasize. And again, Nicole, if you could, for a second, move the camera here. We have lemma 2. Okay,
And you know what happens? Inserted, that's one thing you do. Inserted and contract, that's the second thing you do. So let me spell this out. Let's see, maybe I'll be able to squeeze one here. So we have a summation. The summation goes over I1 less than J1, running between L and 1. Okay, that's what it is there. And the first term from lemma is you contract. You have MI1, MJ1 already contracted. Okay, then you have ML, and ML plus 1 just ends up there and does nothing else. That's the first term from lemma 2. Maybe I'll also put a little, I don't know if it's needed, I can put a little sort of line telling me that this term originates from the second term there. Okay? Maybe I'll try to kind of put a little bars separated. The next one will be, you have to contract ML plus 1 with one of the remaining operators. Okay? So that's going to look like this. We're going to have a summation over I1 less than J1, not exceeding L. Again, that L I like to keep in a circle. And we have a summation over K from 1 to L, okay? But different than I1, J1. I will probably not write this again because it's obvious. We have a normal product of M1, MI1, MJ1. So that's the contraction we had. We are now adding one more, where ML plus 1 is contracted with MK, where K is one of these uncontracted operators. Okay? I'll put a little bar here, because that's what comes from the second term on the other blackboard. Now I move to the next one. Again, two things will happen. So this one also is lemma 2. Insert and contract. So let's write these two maybe here. So when I insert, I'll just have a summation with lots of symbols at it. So right now I'll leave some space there. M1 to MI1, MJ1, MI2, MJ2, ML, ML plus 1. So I just inserted this operator. I have, of course, all these contractions. I inserted ML plus 1 inside. Okay, and I'm summing still over I1 less than J1, I2 less than J2, okay, and all these other things, I1 less than I2, okay, J1 different than J2, or less or equal L. That's the first of the two. And then the second one will involve an extra contraction. You take this ML plus 1 and contract it with one of the remaining operators here. So let me try to write it still on this blackboard. Okay, so what happens is plus, maybe here, a summation. There will be two summations because we'll be doing a contraction. So we have M1 through MI1, MJ1, okay, contracted. Okay, I'll put that MK here. It can be anywhere. So we have I2, J2 contracted, I1, J1 contracted, MK is contracted with ML plus 1. Okay, so I have to sum over the original summations we had, which was I1 less than IJ1, I2 less than J2, I1 less than I2, J1 different than J2, and what is important is all of this less or equal L. And here I have another summation over K running from 1 to L. And obviously the K cannot be what is already contracted. So that's obvious how I will write. Okay? That's what we get. And another bar. Okay? That's what we get from these initial terms. Now we continue. And that dots, let's look at the middle terms. Okay? So what happens in the term which has lambda minus 1 contraction? Once again, put it in. It will look similar to the previous one, except that now we have lambda minus 1 contractions in it. So the next term will be plus the sum over I1 less than J1, I lambda minus 1 less than J lambda minus 1. All these I's are organized J's are different. You know, if you don't sort of write all of this, that's fine. You know, you have a, you can watch it, or you can just mark it that I'm just propagating the summation. So here I want to be precise. This is less or equal L. And what we have in the lambda minus 1 case, we have a normal product of M1, MI1, MJ1, MI lambda minus 1, MJ lambda minus 1, ML, ML plus 1. Okay, that's all that happens there. And then we have to do one more step with this one. We have to contract ML plus 1 with one of the remaining operators. So that's going to be my next writing. And that's going to be very important to see. So it's a summation, two of them, one over the original symbols. So of course, okay, let me write it first. Lambda minus 1 pairs. All the i's are organized. Yeah, so we have lambda minus 1 of them. All the j's are different. And again, what is important is that this is less or equal L. The second summation here runs over k. All right, from 1 to L. Again, different than all these symbols here. And we have a normal product of M1, MI1, MJ1 contracted, M say K, MI lambda minus 1, MJ lambda minus 1 contracted, ML, ML plus 1, ML plus 1 is contracted with MK. Alright, that's lemma 2 applied to this case. And I'll do one more, okay? And the way I'll do it is, because I'm almost running out of space, now I'll slowly start erasing. You know, I hope that we agree that everything is correct. If any concerns, let me know right now. Okay, but right now I'll start removing what we already processed. Okay, and you will see in a moment we're done. It is really that you have to sort of recognize the pattern that emerges. So I'm going to erase already this. We processed these terms. I think we processed this one. We also processed the one with lambda minus one right now. So I think, I hope it's okay. So let's now process the next one, okay? The one that has lambda terms. If this is still here, again, it's going to be similar to the previous one. Insert and contract. But I'll write it so that you can see how things begin to line up. So the next one will be a summation over I1 less than J1, I lambda less than J lambda. There are lambda contractions. I's are organized. Orders and j's are all different. We know that this does not exceed L, and all I have to do now is write the normal product where I have lambda contractions, so I1, j1, and I lambda, j lambda contracted, and then ML, ML plus 1, so I just inserted ML plus 1, okay? Maybe I'll put that, I think I did put that bar, okay, bar here. Okay, and then the second term that comes from lambda contraction will have one extra contraction. So I'll write it as plus a summation over I1 less than J1, I lambda less than J lambda, right? And I's are organized, ordered, and J's are distinct, and less or equal L. But then we'll end up with an additional summation over K, because we're going to be contracting. Okay, and then will be a normal product of M1. Then we have MI1, MJ1, MI, say MK in the middle, fine. MI lambda, MJ lambda. Let's contract the I1, J1, and I lambda with J lambda. And then we have ML, ML plus 1. And we know that this time ML plus 1 contracts here. That is lemma to this case. Okay. Okay, the most labor is behind us. Let's not destroy this. This one. Okay. And now we just have to put more dots. And we have to look at the last terms. What happens to them? Okay? So that's gonna be our next step. Okay, I guess I can erase now this. And I'll hold to the last terms and read them carefully, okay? So again, we'll have two subcases, even L and odd L.
so let's start with the even. Well, for the even case, let's just look at this. What happens? You have ML plus 1. You insert it here. You know, I'm using lemma 2. Lemma 2 each time. Insert it here. What happens? Then you have 1, 2, 3 uncontracted terms in all possible ways. Okay? But you can also add it in and contract with either k prime or k double prime. So then the number of uncontracted operators will be 1 only. Okay? Is this clear? If I take this guy and contract it with either k prime or k double prime, you know, contraction like, then I'll be left with 1 operator uncontracted. But what is important is that that operator will not be L plus 1. Because L plus 1 will be contracted. Okay? So if I really start writing this carefully, okay, you know what I'll do? I'll maybe put these plus dots here to save at least one line for my writing here. Okay? So here we'll say now even L. So the term which we begin to see is a sum. We have a normal product. Let me make sure we also see it. We have m1, m say k minus 1, mk, mk plus 1, ml, ml plus 1, and ml plus 1, and sorry, everything is contracted. So I'm not going to write the term with three uncontracted symbols because it's obvious that it's there, okay? That's the previous term. We already have the middle term with the lambda. Those are the key ones because they cover everything from lambda equal 1 to all of them, right? Contracted. So, you know, so again, I'll put this inside. I have three uncontracted operators. I will not write this, okay? Because we know it's there. I will write only one of them from lemma 2, namely the second term, where ML plus 1 contracts with this or that. Then it will leave us with one uncontracted operator between 1 and L. Okay? So that's what I'm writing right now. I am contracting these operators here, all of these here. This one is left uncontracted. Maybe I'll put it in a circle so we see it. Okay? And I have to sum over all these k values and so on. Let's then look at this one. Well, here, you see, this is already all fully contracted. So I cannot contract it more. All I can do is to throw it in and leave it uncontracted. Is this clear? Again, just make sure, because, you know, okay, if it's clear, then I write it. If it's not, of course, we can always go back to it. So we have a summation, which will look like this. You have M1 through ML, ML plus 1. Everything in this group is contracted. This one remains uncontracted. You can put some dots, but, you know, we don't want there. Okay? That's how the end game will look like for the even L. Okay? Let's look at the odd L then. So with your permission, I'll erase now what took us so much time to write. Okay. I need that. Go ahead. All right. Now let's look at the odd case, okay? Which I will do maybe here because I have enough space. So let's put a line because we know that the last terms are optional. You have to choose one of the two forms. So odd L. Okay? So what happens with odd L? You see everything is contracted here but one operator. So what will happen with lemma? You add it in, you will have two operators uncontracted, but we have it in the previous terms. I'm not going to write that. And then we'll add it in and contract with what is left uncontracted here. Well, that will make it fully contracted. Right? So the very last terms will be fully contracted. So let's just write it. It's going to be n, m1, ml, ml plus 1. And I'll just draw a bunch of lines telling all of this is fully contracted. Okay? As I said, I didn't say there's only one more term where one will be two uncontracted, but two uncontracted goes with the previous ones. Okay, so this is what I can write. Now all we need to do, after all the hard work of writing and rewriting and rewriting, is read it and state the result. So I'm going to erase now this one, and I'll start reading this. Okay? So you have to read it across.
See, lemma, remember, lemma one and two, these two lemmas, they split each term into two. Okay? Like they form little pairs. What we're going to do now, we're going to recombine these pairs, but in a different way than originally. Originally, they came like, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Imagine like this, right? 1, 2 pair, and 2, 3 pair, and then, sorry, 3, 4 pair, and then so on. Now we're going to add 2 to 3, 4 to 5, 6 to 7, adding across on the diagonal, okay? Let's watch this, and I'll be writing the result. So what is the first term? Okay, I'll start writing here, I guess. Very first term on top. So Nicole, please now show this left part. It would be great because lots of terms to watch. And I'll be kind of pointing. It'd be nice to have the traditional stick. Right, you see it there?
Right here.
Ah, here, there it is. It's nothing better than the analog devices. All right? Now I'm not tall enough, I guess, still. But anyway, that one. That's the first term, right? So when we start writing, we started with multiplying L plus one operators, right? That's what we started. You remember we, and then the first term is just normal product of all of them. Oh, this is fantastic, isn't it? That's this one. So we go, please, this one. All right, next. We look at this. Here we are having single contractions, but none of them exceeds L. That one here brings you L plus 1. So if you recombine those two, you end up with a summation with single contraction involving all operators. Okay? Simply second term of the first term of, with a lemma 1 can be combined with the first term of the second term, okay, from lemma 2. All right? Is this clear to everybody? What I'm doing? One more time. I can actually lower it. What I'm doing, I'm combining these two. You see, this belongs to the first term, that belongs to the second term, but I'm going to combine across this way. Because that is a single contraction here, going up to L. That one involves L plus 1. So that means if I recombine, all I need to do is to put L plus 1 here. Okay, just extend my summation. So that's my next term. It's a summation over single contractions. And I will now say that they go up to L plus 1 after this recombining. Okay? And we have a normal product of M1 through MI1, MJ1. Last term is ML plus 1. Okay? And we're considering all possible contractions, including the last operator. Okay? All right. Let's move on. Here. You see, we have here. Here we have two contractions, but none of them goes up, involves L plus 1. It stops right here. That's why I was telling you that is very important, little thing, but some important here. Okay? The previous term involves the missing contraction involving L plus 1. So I can recombine it across this way. And all I need to do is to simply extend the summation to include L plus 1. Okay? So that's going to be my next term. It's a summation over I1 less than J1, I2 less than J2, and all these other things we need to write. You know, I1 less than I2, J1 different than J2, and then a normal product of M1, MI1, MJ1, MI2, MJ2, and L plus 1 is now your last operator, so your pairs of contractions. And I just have to say that this term can be buried here by extending this to L plus 1. And that's what I'm going to say now. Less or equal L plus 1, again in a circle. It sounds so important, apparently. Okay? All right. So I'll move on. Okay? The next terms. So maybe, again, I'll follow the same philosophy as before. I'll start erasing what we processed, if you don't mind. Okay, so we already processed this. We processed this. Okay, and we processed this. And that. Okay, we have to now go to the more generic case. Of course, you know, I will soon erase this one, because you see what we have here are
triple contractions, but you can imagine that the triple contractions involving L plus 1 will combine with triple contractions without L plus 1. Okay? So that will again recombine across. So I will erase. Okay? This will combine with the next term which I didn't write. So let's focus then on the generic terms in the middle, where we have lambda contractions. Okay? Almost there. You see, again, we have lambda minus 1 contractions. Okay? We have lambda contractions here. So this one I will not write anymore because that's lambda minus 1 contractions. It will go with the previous terms. There are lambda contractions here, sorry, right? That is lambda minus 1 plus 1 extra contraction involving L plus 1. And the next term has lambda contractions. So again, I can combine them across. Okay? I can take this term here. Again, let me point to it. See, this one has lambda contractions, but none of them involves the last operator. This one has also lambda contractions total, but one of the contractions involves L plus 1. So I can recombine the middle terms into lambda contractions involving all operators. Okay? So that's going to be my very next expression. Okay? So maybe I'll do it right here. Okay, so the next term is what you see there, except that you have to extend the summation. Okay, so we have a summation, and we have normal product of M1 to MI1, MJ1, MI lambda, MJ lambda, and L plus 1. Now we have lambda contractions involving the last operator. So I1 less than J1, I lambda less than J lambda. All I's are ordered, J's are different, and all of this is less or equal L plus 1. Okay? So once again, one last time, I guess. L lambda contractions here involving the last operator, lambda contractions there not involving it. All together, you know, when you combine, you have contractions involving, lambda contractions involving all operators, including the last one. So I can then, I guess, slowly erase these. Okay? All right, so now we are sort of right somewhere in the middle. And of course, after this, you continue. You know, the next step is, you can see, if you look at this one, okay? You look at this one, it has lambda contractions plus one extra. That's lambda plus one contractions. Then it will combine with the next one. You know, which will have lambda plus 1 contractions without ML plus 1. Okay? And you continue. And then you end up with the final term. Okay? So what I'll do now is I'll clean the blackboard such that we see only what we need to see. Okay? So if you don't mind, now I'll erase this. We already processed this term, which has lambda contractions without ML plus 1. It's over there already. And there was another term which had ML plus 1, we included it, so we can now erase this. Okay? Now this term, as I said, has lambda plus 1 contractions, but then it goes with the next one after it. So I'm going to erase it as well. Okay? And I will leave the endpoints because we already sort of processed them, right? Because you can see now that, so I will simply put plus dot, 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 and after this you end up with the what you see on the right blackboard, okay? So again, you can see now, I think we probably see now the entire, if you could maybe, Nicole, somehow show all four, well, three blackboards, let's do it this way, artistically, all right? So the way you read this is this. We have M1 up to ML plus 1 gives you a normal product of L plus 1 operators plus normal products with one single contractions of L plus 1 operators plus normal products of double contractions with L plus 1 operators. Then you continue from this blackboard, you go with dots to this one. Here we have lambda contractions including all operators, and then when you're done there you go to the last terms which are labeled here with even or odd. And you can see everything makes sense. Because when L is even, well then L plus 1 is odd.
Well, if Alpha's one is odd, you have to have one operator left uncontracted. And that's what you see. It's either the last one left uncontracted, or one of the middle ones. So everything, you know, is fair and square here. Okay? Now, if you look at the last case when, last sort of types of terms when L is odd, that's here. Well, when L is odd, then L plus 1 is even. Well, when L plus 1 is even, your last term will be certainly fully contracted. You got that right. Well, I guess I'm happy to say that we completed the proof of Weak's theorem. We simply proved that the induction assumption for L operators after multiplication by L plus 1 and using lemma 1 and 2 and then resumming across, like on the diagonal, right, allowed us to prove, to show Weak's theorem for L plus 1 operators, which is, of course, the induction step. Okay? All right, so I think this is really a good time to take a little break and sort of absorb all of this information. Anyway, we have Weak's theorem behind us. That's a massive undertaking. It's an important theorem. It will allow us to do a lot of things. The next step will be a small generalization of it called the generalized Weak's theorem, okay, which will apply to situations where some of the operators M here are pre-contracted. That is, some will, sorry, pre-ordered. They will come in the normal order form. And the reason I want to have it is that we will use later operators, we'll try, in the normal product form. Because when you do this, you will see that certain contractions don't need to be written. Here, when I write a simple product of operators, I have to write all possible contractions. But if some of the operators among the M's are in the normal ordered form, you will see next on Friday, you do not have to contract operators that are inside the same M group. That's the generalized form of the Weak's theorem. And this will be the same as in diagrams. You do not have to if operators are in the normal product form, you do not have to draw diagrams where lines go back to the same vertex. You know, the bubble diagrams that you see sometimes people draw, you don't have to do this. I will try to convince you, you don't have to do this. Use operators in the normal product form, don't draw bubble diagrams of little circles and so on and so forth. They look cool, but no need to draw them. It's a waste of time. Because we can accommodate them through the normal ordering. And then save ourselves quite a bit of time. Okay? Anyway, that's all for Friday and after that. So, thank you very much. I'll see you on Friday. Take care. As always, remember about the homework. Please bring it on a piece of paper, right? So I can bring it over the weekend. And I will read the new solutions. The solutions of homework 1 and the homework 2 set on Friday.